12 million people basically watching a 17-year-old kid learn this song in record time. Claude Michel and Cameron has a really good story. Claude Michel's story for that is my music so predictable that this girl just knows it right away? It's like there's that. And then Cameron, the way he talks about it is just because, of course, he was present in the rehearsal studio, in the audition, when they asked me to finally sing the song, I think it might have been I'd Give My Life for You at this point. It's like, can you go, you stand there on the X and you sing I'd Give My Life for You. I'm like, which version? It's like, what do you mean, which version? Like, every time you've taught it to me, it's been five different ways, so which one do you want me to do? He's like, that you remember every single one. it's still something he remembers. And that was a million years ago. And that was a moment that was never on film. Did not anticipate how much my life would change thanks to those auditions. Learning that song, learning that first one, and then all the other songs on that day, like, my life is gonna change. I don't think the description has changed much when telling an actor what it is. When they first described her to me at the auditions, it was just very bare bones. It was, Kim is the 17-year-old bar girl from Saigon. Her parents were both killed in this ensuing conflict. She falls in love with an American GI, has a child with him, and, you know, tries to reunite with this GI and finds out that he is married. I think now, because there are so many actors that have done the role in many parts of the world, I think it's good that the bare bones of that has remained. To give the actor coming into it the freedom to interpret it in their own way, with their own life experience coming into it. Because to try and adhere to how one person did it or how the first person did it, it's like, no, she did it that way, therefore you have to do it that way. It kind of takes away your creativity and freedom as an actor to turn this into something that is uniquely yours. When that original batch of Filipinos left the Philippines to be in that original West End production in London in 1989, people like Isai Alvarez, Junix Enoshan, may he rest in peace, Bobby Martino, Miguel Diaz, folks from here. I think it started there. And the attention that the show garnered because of the auditions, that the auditions were just on blast for so many people that were hoping for the opportunity to get to go to London. And then here is this group of like 15, all in all, including those that were hired out of London, that were part of this production that became a huge hit. And even 35 years on, so beloved. I think even Cameron McIntosh, I don't think it was something he even expected to happen, that it would reach this level, and that there have been the revival production, and then there's this touring production. There are people that still love the show, and I think Filipinos in particular, past that 2000 production, have felt a connection to it, and it makes me incredibly happy that there are younger theater goers, that it tends to skew younger. For that to be happening, it makes me extremely happy that those envelopes are still being pushed. As an 18-year-old from the Philippines, I could not have anticipated that happening 35 years later, 34 years later, 35 years later. I did not foresee that. I mean, representation has become such a byword, much more now than it was back then. And when you see a whole bunch of people on stage and you are someone that looks exactly like them, seeing that, that does something to you, even if you're not always conscious of what's happening. You see somebody that looks like you up on stage, making their own dreams come true, it's very empowering. And the show itself, it's not this static thing. I mean, even in the casting of the character of the engineer, I mean, in the UK, there was a production in Sheffield where Joe Ampil got to play that character. And now, coming to the Philippines, Sean Miley Moore, this fabulous queer human being is occupying that role. There are gonna be queer theatergoers watching this, and they're going to look to that gorgeous human and find something to relate to and see themselves. It's powerful. It's really powerful.
And I think even for the performers, they've recognized that in being able to perform in front of an audience that looks like them.
That's going to be crazy. So I think for those Asian performers to look out into the audience and to see their own reflections, it's going to be a very emotional experience. And I don't think even they anticipate what they are going to feel like when, you know, when that curtain call happens and there are enough lights to illuminate the audience. And yeah, I think it's going to be something that I don't think they have no idea what's going to hit them.
They're all saying they're ready for this motherland energy. They don't
no, they're not ready for this motherland.
Ready.
No. I mean, I'm used to it because this is where I'm from. I've performed in front of Filipino audiences all my life. I still do. But for those who have not, they're not ready for, they're, no. They, you know, I mean, backstage crew and staff need to have Kleenex on standby. I mean, the dressers usually already do anyway, but I think an extra supply at the very first performance. They're all gonna need something because it's going to hit them hard and they won't always be able to articulate why. Hi, this is Lea Salonga. Come and see Miss Saigon when it arrives in Manila this March at the Theater at Solaire.